So we're going to talk and review the history and the biologic rationale for the use of hypofractionated radiation therapy or stereotactic radiation therapy for localized prostate cancer. We'll address and understand many limitations or weaknesses in the commonly utilized arguments against the use of SBRT and discuss some of the ongoing trials. So this is the debate that wasn't. This was originally planned as a debate between the pros and cons of prostate stereotactic radiotherapy. And Ron Chen, my friend from UNC, was supposed to cover the cons, but he mysteriously wasn't able to come, or he chose not to attend. However, what might Ron have said if he was here? He might have said, it's too new, it's experimental, it's unproven. It's not safe. You can't do that. That's crazy. It requires special equipment or technology, so it's really not transferable to the general radiation oncology population. And it's really just not cost-effective with all these extra equipments. So let's start with dose response in prostate cancer. So this is from Dr. Fowler back in 2009, looking at biochemical control from a number of series based on equivalent two-gray fractions for standard fractionated radiation therapy. And what you can see is there's a dose response, not surprising for all of us that practice in this field. And this was demonstrated to have an advantage originally in the MD Anderson dose escalation trial, where you could escalate radiation therapy by 8 gray and see about a 15% improvement in biochemical control at 10 years, albeit at the cost of increased GI toxicity using these relatively crude conventional radiation techniques. So why do we fractionate? You know, going back to Hall, everyone probably has some edition of Hall in their textbook at home on the bookcase. We know that we fractionate because tumors are assumed to behave like early responding tissues, where fractionation does not cause a substantial detriment in outcome compared to single fractions of radiation. Whereas normal tissues are assumed to behave like late reacting tissues, where fractionation gains us a therapeutic advantage. But what if we have this backwards? What if the normal tissues and tumors are the other way around? In that case, fractionation might actually be the wrong thing to do and might not get us the therapeutic index we want. So a number of studies have looked at what might be the alpha beta of prostate cancer. Many of them used LDR or HDR data, which had been thought to perhaps contaminate it. So this is one study that used just external beam radiation patients. It was pooled from multiple institutions, including the RTOG, with over 5,000 men, and they looked at long-term biochemical control. Fraction sizes were all between 1.8 and 2.7 gray, and within this range, they came up with the conclusion that the alpha beta of prostate cancer probably was in the range of 1.5, albeit the confidence interval was relatively broad, going from less than 1 to almost 5. So if you go back to Dr. Fowler's paper from 2009, you can see the dose response curve here from before, now blown up. And going northwest from that, laterally to the left, you see a curve where he had postulated isoeffective fractionation schemes going from 39 fractions of 2 gray, the MD Anderson standard, to 26 fractions, 20 fractions, 15 fractions, 10 fractions, and all the way down to 5 fractions. And he had postulated that with an alpha beta of 1.5 for prostate cancer, these would be isotoxic regimens that might actually lead to increased biochemical control. So let's talk about some of the data for hypofractionation. There's some old data that we'll try to skip past quickly using low-dose radiation therapy with hypofractionation. And then there's some more modern data using moderate hypofractionation that's more equivalent to dose-escalated radiation. The oldest data that's actually perhaps most relevant is that from England from 1962 to 1984, where they treated 209 patients with a fractionation regimen of 6 gray times 6 to 36 gray, delivering 2 fractions per week. They reported excellent results. It was economical. It was less trying or wearing for the patients. And there were no major early or late morbidity. Now, I'm not showing you results here, because patients from 1962 to 1984 had large, bulky tumors. They would have had high PSAs if we had PSA available. And so the results are not outstanding compared to what we'd expect, but the toxicities were modest, and this was using very old technology. So that was a St. Thomas Hospital experience. There was also the Canadian randomized trial from back in the early 1980s that used 2.6 Gray fractions, and the Australian randomized trial that used 2.75 Gray fractions. Both of these were not testing a hypothesis of hypofractionation. They were testing commonly used regimens and what their outcomes may be. And they were reasonable. Toxicity was not substantially different. Outcomes were not substantially different compared to low-dose radiation, typically in the 64 to 66 Gray range in 2 Gray fractions. The first sort of modern dose-escalated experience came from Pat Capellian from the Cleveland Clinic. He tested a regimen of 70 Gray in 28 fractions of 2.5 Gray. He used image guidance for all of it, which I think is critically important, using the BAT ultrasound. And they were treated with an early IMRT technique. Margins were really quite small, particularly for when they started this treatment. In particular, the posterior margin was only 4 millimeters. Here's their results from 2007, and what you can see for low-risk outcomes, better than 90% local biochemical control out to about 8 years, with decrements for intermediate and high-risk disease. But importantly, GI toxicity was very modest, with late urinary toxicity not atypical for what we would see with a conventionally fractionated regimen. So a number of studies have now looked at modest hypofractionation, single-arm studies as depicted here, and then actually a number of randomized trials have now assessed different regimens between 2.4 and 3.4 Gray per fraction. Some of these have been published, some of these have just been presented. In general, the hypofractionation arms have not been inferior. Late grade 3-4 toxicities have been rare. There have been conflicting results about grade 2 toxicities. Patient-reported quality of life has really been quite good. So the largest North American experience was presented at this ACRO this last year by Robert Lee. This was RTOG 0415. This tested the Cleveland Clinic or Capellian regimen of 2.5 to 70 Gray, as depicted here in red, as compared to 73.8 Gray in 1.8 Gray fractions in blue. And as you can see, out to 7 years, biochemical control was between 8 and 12%, which was not different between arms. So what about stereotactic radiotherapy for prostate cancer? Take hypofractionation to the extreme from that Fowler plot. I love this graphic, prostate cancer, I have better things to do. But more importantly is the website, cancerbeware.com. So prostate SBRT is in a situation right now where a number of single institutional or multi-institutional studies have been published. It's hard to keep track, but it's at least 25 to 30 at this time. The vast majority are for low or intermediate risk prostate cancer. So here's a reflection of the different fractionation schedules that have been used. 6.7 Gray times 5, which was developed by the Swedish Cancer Institute in Seattle. That was supposed to be an equal potent regimen as 78 and 2 and be less toxic, all the way up to the regimen from UT Southwestern at 10 Gray times 5. Which reflects Dr. Timmerman's cowboy mentality. And then there's actually a study from Spain, which I've seen an abstract for, but has not been published, which was actually 24 Gray times 1. But most of the data is clustered in the range between 7.25 times 5 to 8 Gray times 5, as depicted here. And we will highlight the Timmerman data later as an example of perhaps what not to do. So what are the results? So here's just a collection of a number of these single-arm studies, and what are the results? In general, median follow-up has been between 3 and 6 years. Biochemical relapse-free survival at 5 years was between 90 and 99% for low-risk disease, and between 84 and 97% for intermediate-risk disease. Most of these studies are small, in the range of 50 to 100 patients, although there are a couple of very large studies, in particular that from Dr. Katz on Long Island and from the Georgetown group. There are three notable exceptions, which we will talk about as well, from Dr. Yu, Dr. Boyke, and Dr. Kim. So here's the largest experience to date published. This is from Dr. Katz in Long Island. This is his follow-up with a median follow-up of 7 years. It's a combination of low and intermediate risk disease. Most of the patients got 7.25 Gray times 5, although a smaller portion got 7 Gray times 5. And what you can see is going out to 8 years, 96 months, there's 96% biochemical control in the low-risk group and 89% in the intermediate-risk group. And somewhat tellingly, PSA nadirs were really quite low. PSA nadirs are really what you'd get in the vicinity of a typical brachytherapy series as about 0.1. So there was a pooled analysis that was done as well. It included Dr. Katz's data, but it was about 1,100 patients from 8 institutions. All prospective phase 2 trials. Follow-up for the pooled analysis was relatively short at a median of 1 year with a range between 1 and 7 years. The majority of the patients were low risk, 58%. There was a small portion of intermediate risk and only about 125 patients with high risk. Androgen therapy was relatively uncommonly used, 14% for the whole group, and about a third of the high-risk patients. Doses range between 35 and 40 gray in 4 to 5 fractions. So here are these results, and again, what you can see is biochemical control at 5 years, 95% for the pooled low-risk cohort of over 600 patients, 84% for intermediate risk, and 81% for high-risk. Although I will note, high risk, there were 3 patients at 5 years. So that's a little bit early, I think, to make any strong convictions about this data. They did look at, on univariate analysis, association between androgen therapy use and dose to see if there was a relationship here. They came to the conclusion that there was no statistically significant difference for androgen therapy use. However, and there was no statistical difference for radiation dose. However, it's worth noting that both androgen therapy and dose were not randomly selected. And so if you look at the differences in intermediate risk disease, it certainly seems to suggest that there might be a dose response and there might be an androgen response. And I think you'd really want to have patient-level data to analyze risk factors, because we all know that intermediate risk patients are not all the same. So what about toxicity? So this is a study from Myers et al. That pooled data from multiple SBRT studies on the left of these two graphs from external beam published series, including the Dutch randomized trial, the MD Anderson randomized trial, the Memorial Sloan Kettering IMRT experience, the MGH proton experience, and then brachytherapy using the multi-institutional RTOG 9805 data. Late urinary toxicity is on the left, late GI toxicity on the right. Yellow represents grade 2 toxicity, red reflects grade 3 toxicity. The numbers are quite small and hard to see, but I think what you see in general is the rates of toxicity are less than what is reported for most of the other series. Now, I will admit many of those series used old and antiquated techniques, and so I think results with external beam conventionally fractionated this time are certainly substantially better than that, but certainly SBRT does not look worse than what we were comfortable doing for many years. Does timing influence toxicity? I have to admit this is a bit controversial in the SBRT literature, but Chris King, when he was at Stanford, ran one of the first CyberKnife studies that was published, and he looked at timing of radiation. Initially, they planned on giving this 5 days a week, 5 fractions in 1 week, and what they noticed was more acute toxicity than they had anticipated. So then they lengthened it to every other day, 2 to 2.5 fractions, 2 to 3 fractions a week. And what they saw when they compared retrospectively in a non-randomized fashion was greater late GU toxicity and greater late GI toxicity in those given single daily fractions versus over 2 weeks. Now, it's also true that they were learning as they went along. Volumes and dose constraints may have improved, but at least this suggests that timing may be important. How about dose? Does dose influence toxicity? The top graph here is again from Dr. Katz. It's about 600 patients with long-term follow-up. And you can see at least a trend that both urinary toxicity of grade 1, 2, and 3 appeared to be greater with 7.25 gray times 5 as compared to 7 gray times 5. And similarly with rectal toxicity. Now in this analysis, both of the p-values are greater than 0.5, so you could not say that this was a statistically significant association. However, relatively recently, from Sunnybrook in Toronto, they reported at the ASCO GU meeting that they saw a similar relationship. They had a broader range of doses. They used 7 gray times 5 in the first trial and 8 gray times 5 in the second trial, and they did clearly see an association between both GU and rectal toxicity with the higher doses. All right, so toxicity is interesting, but how about quality of life? So, a number of studies have been done. I'll show again data from Dr. Meyer and some of the data that we did ourselves. The graphs here are taken from the Marty Sanda's PROSQA study, which was a multi-institutional study run from 2000 to 2006, where patients all filled out the EPIC quality of life questionnaire before, during, and after radiation. And so the top graph you see there is the urinary incontinence score on a range from 0 to 100 on average for the patients treated with external beam radiation therapy, and on the bottom, the same urinary incontinence score, but for those treated with LDR brachytherapy. There was no quality assurance for these. There were no margins. There was no standardized use of IMRT. There was no standardized use of imaging. So we can't necessarily extrapolate to what's being done now almost 10 years later, but this is at least what we saw. We saw a transient decline in urinary incontinence score, meaning an increase in incontinence that peaked for external beam right at the end of therapy and then got better, and for brachytherapy, peaked or nadired, if you will, also early on, and then got better over a slower period of time. And if you overlay the results with SBRT, what you can see is that, particularly compared to the brachytherapy, there was not quite as deep of a peak, and then things settled out very similarly over time. If you do the same thing with urinary obstruction, you can see that the urinary obstructive symptoms really seem to parallel that seen with external beam. You can see the point at the end of treatment is substantially earlier because it's a 5-fraction regimen. But importantly, the peak was not, the nadir was not as deep as those treated with brachytherapy. And again, in the long run, results are quite similar. For the bowel score, again, a similar phenomenon. It tends to parallel that seen with either brachytherapy or external beam with no substantial differences over the course of therapy. And then for sexual score, again, a modest decline in sexual function within the first few months and then relative stability out over 2 years. We did a similar analysis using a large cohort of patients treated with SBRT from 21st Century Oncology on a LINAC-based platform and from Georgetown using SBRT. This is, again, the EPIC 26 difference. It's presented a little difference. What this is presented as is the proportion of patients with a detectable change defined as a half standard deviation. So this isn't necessarily toxicity. This is where if you ask the patient, could they say it was different compared to when they started? And so in the upper left, you can see obstruction. And so black is the brachytherapy. So 2 months after brachytherapy, not surprisingly, better than 80% of the patients said their urinary function was different than when they started. But when you went out 2 years, that had declined to about 50%. SBRT and IMRT had both had very similar, where urinary changes were detectable in 60% or so of patients early on, but by the time you got out to 2 years, it was only about 25 to 30%. And these were both better than brachytherapy. Incontinence was less common and resolved to similar levels across all groups. Bowel function, interestingly, the brachytherapy group and the IMRT group both had very similar bowel profiles in terms of detectable changes, whereas the SBRT group actually had less prevalent changes in bowel function, such that by going out 2 years, less than 20% of the patients had any detectable change from baseline. And sexual function, again, relatively similar. So why is SBRT better for quality of life? Is this the power of the alpha beta with lower total dose leading to less toxicity? Or is this really the power of smaller margins? The IMRT data was from 2000 to 2006, as I told you, no central quality assurance, no plan of approval. And I think there are really two small studies that I'll highlight that used much smaller margins and got quality of life that was quite similar. So I think some of this may be SBRT, but a lot of it's probably better technology. So the first is the AIM trial that was run, again, by 21st Century Oncology. This used electromagnetic transponders, or the Calypso beacons. And what they looked at is the acute change in quality of life for patients treated with 81 gray external beam radiation therapy in 1.8 gray fractions with 3 millimeter margins with Calypso. And that's the blue bars. So this is the decrement from start to the first time point at the end of radiation. And in purple bars are the data, again, from that Sanda study, looking at patients treated with IMRT. And what you can see is with small margins, there appear to be a substantially less decline in bowel function, urinary irritation obstruction, and sexual function, although urinary incontinence was a relatively modest decline in each of those. And so I would suggest that this is related to using very small margins and limiting the rectum and bladder that's radiated. We ran a small randomized phase 2 trial using gold markers and 3-millimeter margins, and collected EPIC data over time. And what we saw was that the urinary, bowel, and sexual declines were all quite a bit more modest by limiting the tissues outside the prostate were radiated. So I think much of the benefit that we see with SBRT is using a very small number of fractions where you can be very careful and you can use very small margins and you can get away with it. So what if you don't like SBRT? What is the data out there that says this is not a good idea to do? And I highlighted before these three papers. So the first is from James Yu at Yale. He looked at SEER data matched with billing data from Medicare and looked at genital urinary events at 6, 12, and 24 months. And what he saw was, as compared to IMRT, billed in SEER and Medicare. And what you can see is at 24 months, there were 7.7% more billing claims for urologic procedures or office visits in those treated with SBRT. And for GI symptoms, there was a slightly greater difference at 6 months, but no differences over time. So I don't quite know what to make of these data. These are billing data. These are not necessarily toxicity. They reflect different practices and different referral patterns, but they at least are there. The one study, another study came again from Canada, looking at a phase 1-2 trial. This study only had 18 patients in it. It's unique in that it was a study for high-risk patients. They used 8 gray times 5 to 40 gray to the prostate, at the same time, 5 gray times 5 to the pelvic lymph nodes, as can seen here. You don't see any markers in the prostate. That's because they used cone beam CT without fiducial markers. And this was early on in their experience. They actually didn't have a whole lot of dose constraints that were appropriate for their treatment. And what they found was in their 18 patients, they actually had 3 patients with late grade 3 GI toxicity and 1 patient with grade 4 who required a surgical procedure. They do note that that one patient had pre-existing GI dysfunction, perhaps may not have been a good patient to treat on the trial, but at least this is a hint that 4 out of 18 patients had a relatively high GI toxicity. But the series to really make one worried about is that came from UT Southwestern and a number of other institutions. They ran a phase 1-2 trial of stereotactic body radiation therapy with a rectal balloon. It was platform independent. Most of it was done with a LINAC. And this is what they did. They started the trial in 2006. The phase 1 portion had 45 patients, 9 gray times 5, 9.5 times 5, and 10 gray times 5. If you recall back to the original slide about the alpha, beta, and the biologically equivalent dose, these are really astronomical doses. I think this reflects Dr. Timmerman thinking we can radiate the lung all we want. Let's do the same in the prostate. They published their phase 1 data in JCO. They had a median of 9 months follow-up in the highest dose arm, and they deemed it safe. They then took the high dose arm of 10 gray times 5 and treated another 50 patients. So with a median follow-up of only 24 months, range between 1 and 66, these are the dose groups again, and what they saw was of the 61 patients treated in the high dose arm, 10% developed grade 3, 4 rectal toxicity, and in fact, 5 out of 6 required a colostomy. So not a particularly good thing to do to men who may not necessarily have needed their prostate cancers treated in the first place. The one useful bit of information, we learned something about rectal tolerance. And so what they determined was that 35% of the rectal wall at 39 gray appeared strongly correlated with rectal toxicity, and the volume of rectal wall receiving 50 gray appeared strongly correlated. So for instance, all the grade 4 toxicity patients had more than 3.5 milliliters above 50 gray, and none of the patients with less than 3.5 milliliters had a grade 4 toxicity. Just as a comparison, we started a trial contemporaneous with their study. We used a lower dose and went cautiously. And for instance, we put a maximum point dose of 105% of our prescription dose, or 39 gray, in the rectum, and wanted less than 2 cc's above 37 gray. And we've really seen outstanding quality of life data and almost no toxicity. So I would say, do not treat the prostate to 10 gray times 5. So what about randomized trials? There are actually randomized trials ongoing. I will highlight several of these. The Vidmark trial from Sweden has completed accrual. In Sweden, they don't care that SBRT requires 5 fractions in America, so they're testing 7 fractions of 42.7 gray. Sorry, 7 fractions to 42.7 gray as compared to 39 fractions. This data will likely be available, I think, in a couple of years. At last ACRO, the data was presented on the RTOG 0938 trial. This compared to 2 accelerated fractionation schemes, a 5-fraction regimen, much like I've just shown you, compared to a 12-fraction regimen. Indeed, both of these were actually substantially better in terms of quality of life than was anticipated, and neither of them was even close to the stopping rules. University of Miami is running their Miami Heat trial. I can never figure that out. It has something to do with hypofractionation and acceleration, but that's a 5-fraction regimen, again, that parallels that used by most of the CyberKnife institutions, and it's compared to Dr. Pollack's follow-up hypofractionation trial of 26 fractions. The most interesting trial is actually the PACE trial. So the PACE trial is being done in UK. It's a randomized trial for men with low or intermediate risk prostate cancer. It's an ambitious trial, 1,700 patients. First, it's assessed whether the patients are a surgical candidate. And if they are a surgical candidate, then they are randomized versus surgery versus SBRT. And in patients who are not a surgical candidate, then they are randomized between SBRT and the British standard of 76 gray and 2 gray fractions. As of yesterday, they'd completed 16% enrollment. I think it's enrolling a little bit slow, so whether they will achieve their total target, I don't know, but I think there'll be interesting data nevertheless. There's a little bit of data about high risk, but I'm going to skip that in the issue of time and talk about how does one actually do this? Immobilization is important. Vacuum bag, body frame, abdominal compression, these types of devices are commonly utilized. And so typically CT simulation with gold markers, 3 to 4, a comfortably full bladder, an empty rectum. Supine position, although actually with use of radio transponder beacons, we treated several patients prone and it worked just fine. A non-contrast CT, and potentially an MRI as well, above the iliac crest in relatively small slices. This study looked at plans compared between CyberKnife robotic radiosurgery and LINAC-based, and essentially came to the conclusion that there weren't substantial differences. CyberKnife tends to run a little hotter in the CTV and the PTV because it's a more heterogeneous dose distribution. The LINAC was a little bit cooler in the early phases of the rectum. There have been three studies published using LINAC-based, one from Milan, one from Toronto, the largest actually from 21st Century Oncology, 102 low-risk patients treated with Calypso guidance in 40 gray and 5 fractions. At 6 years, they had 1 biochemical failure of 102 patients, and they had modest toxicity and quality of life. This is an example of what we utilized in our Calypso-based, really an IMRT-based SBRT. I think what's important to look at is in the DVH in the upper right corner is we did identify the urethra either on MRI or on a Foley catheter scan and put urethral limits on just like you would use for HDR. We saw really very, very good urinary obstructive and irritative symptoms, better than many of the CyberKnife studies, I think because of that reason. In fact, many of the CyberKnife centers are now using a urethral constraint on their own, although they got that on their own. They didn't get it from us. This is an example of what Pat Capellian is doing at UCLA using a VMAT system. They use two arcs broken up into 4 half arcs. They do cone beam CT at the beginning and line up with ExactTrack, then do a cone beam CTV. They deliver half an arc, re-ExactTrack. If things look good, deliver another one and do a cone beam. If things don't look good after a half an arc, they'll repeat the cone beam and reline up the patients. There are some collimator shifts so that you don't have overlapping of leaves. Image guidance is clearly important, particularly for intrafraction motion. Magnetic transponders like Calypso, repeat x-rays like with CyberKnife or what Dr. Capellian is using is important. Cone beam CT does provide a number of advantages. It allows you to assess rotations, deformations, rectal bladder filling. The use of endorectal balloons is a little bit up in the air yet. The use of rectal spacers, I'll show you a little bit of data about that. So this is a CineMR that Pat Cavallian provided me showing motion of one particular patient and then six traces of what motion looked like for six different patients. And so you can see, for instance, the patient in the upper right had essentially no motion whatsoever, and you wouldn't have to worry about it, whereas these are all examples of sort of high motion patients, and you can see there's dramatically different motion patterns. And the scale on the y-axis here is in millimeters. And so some of these are moving as much as a centimeter or more over the course of a treatment, which if you're using margins of 3 or 4 millimeters could be obviously critically important. So intrafraction monitoring is critical. Rectal balloons may decrease some of the motion. Here's motion evaluation with and without endorectal balloons. And so 5% of the patients with a rectal balloon had motion greater than 3 millimeters as compared to 20% without a balloon. However, there is some concern that balloons may push different portions of the rectum in the way. There's one small study done with Spacor, the product from Augmenix, looking at putting distance between the rectum and the prostate, which is shown in the DVH on the lower right there, which does provide substantial improvement in the space and therefore potential sparing. Bob Timmerman at UT Southwestern is now running a trial. They've stepped down their dose, I believe, to 9.5 gray, and they're using Spacor to allow space between the rectum and prostate. Target definition, most people would use an MRI, although there are some data without. Organs at risk, we'll skip over those. Essentially, dose constraints come from HDR. In particular, a urethral constraint is probably important. This is just an example of the dose constraints that we utilized, and again, point dose is limited in the rectum to not substantially more than the prescription, and then urethral doses and bladder point doses also limited. We'll skip the tips for minimizing bowel symptoms and urinary symptoms, and we will note, ACRO's model policy from 2013 has now said, in ACRO's opinion, that data supporting the use of SBRT for prostate cancer have matured to the point where SBRT could be considered an appropriate alternative for selected patients with low to intermediate risk disease. In addition, NCCN guidelines starting in 2014 and all the way to 2016 have now said extremely hypofractionated image-guided IMRT, SBRT regimens, 6.5 gray per fraction or greater, are an emerging treatment modality with single institution and pooled results of similar efficacy and toxicity to conventionally fractionated regimens. They can be considered as cautious, my underline, alternative to conventionally fractionated regimens at clinics with an appropriate technology, physics, and clinical expertise. Then looking at cost, there have been about 8 different cost analyses. This is one that just has nice lines, and what you can see is the cost for SBRT is sort of down here in the bottom. It's more expensive than LDR brachytherapy. It's less expensive than radical prostatectomy or IMRT. It's similar to HDR. The line that goes diagonally there is active surveillance, and so the authors of this article made the contention that it might be cost-effective compared to active surveillance because surveillance costs increase over time with repeat biopsies and then a portion of patients being treated. What about those who say, I'm not going to use SBRT until the level one evidence has been published? I stand on conviction. Where's your level one evidence for lung SBRT? Where's your level one evidence for liver SBRT? Where's your level one evidence for the only urologist I know in the room for robotic radical prostatectomy? Or in prostate cancer, where is your level one evidence for IMRT, for IGRT, for LDR monotherapy, or HDR monotherapy? Much of what we do doesn't base in prostate cancer on level one evidence, but we do it anyways. So what are some of the questions that remain? What's the best fractionation schedule? 4 gray times 9, 4 fractions of 9 gray, 5 fractions of 7 to 8 gray, which is where most of the data resides, 7 fractions of 6 gray, what they're doing in Sweden. I know 10 gray times 5 is too high. How should the dose distribute? We used a homogeneous dose like IMRT. Should you use a heterogeneous dose like brachytherapy, where the entire prostate runs relatively high, 150 to 200%? Or should you use a heterogeneous dose where you boost the dominant nodule but keep the rest of the gland near the prescription dose? We don't know these answers. Is there a role for androgen therapy for intermediate or for high-risk disease? If so, for how long? How about high-risk disease? Should we do like they did in Canada and like they're doing at UCLA, 5 gray times 8, potentially treat the nodes 5 gray times 5? Or should we do like Georgetown has done, 45 gray with conventionally fractionated radiation, and then boost with SBRT, much like we would do with HDR, of 3 fractions of 7.25, all delivered with androgen therapy, We don't know the answers to these questions. So I think the merits of prostate SBRT, particularly for low and intermediate risk cases, is that it appears to be as effective as IMRT, brachytherapy, or protons. It really has a low toxicity profile. It's short course and non-invasive. It's cheaper than IMRT or protons, better use of resources, easier patient access. So if Dr. Chen were here, I would ask him, do you think it's ready for prime time? And if you go to the UNC website, one of his direct titles is Director of Cyberknife Cancer. So I think Dr. Chen would agree. So I'll thank Pat Capellian and Sean Collins, who provided some of the slides, and for Ron Chen for putting up with me poking fun of him when he's not here. Thanks very much.
So radiotherapy for oligometastatic prostate cancer, certainly something that a lot of people are talking about. And here are a number of disclosures. That off-label usage at the bottom, there's a little caveat to that if you look in the speaker guidelines and speaker disclosures. So what advances have prompted us to reconsider radiotherapy for oligometastatic disease? Certainly improved imaging. We'll talk a lot about that. Improved radiotherapeutic targeting, whether it's with fiducials, Calypso beacons, cone beam CT, improved resolution of conventional scanning, and also improved systemic therapy where we may knock down the disease to a few sites with the use of such a newer antigen deprivation therapy agents as abiraterone, enzalutamide, and others, as well as the use of docetaxel earlier in the disease process. So what are we going to cover? Introduction, some definitions, talk a little bit about different metastatic sites and prognoses, imaging, particularly advanced imaging, how are we approaching the radiotherapeutic management, and which areas are supported by guidelines and which are outside the box. So let's pull out a definition of oligometastasis, because there certainly isn't a standard for it. And going back to Sam Hellman, Ralph Wechselbaum from 1995, over 20 years ago, JCO, from consideration of these theories of cancer dissemination in the light of the emerging information on the multi-step nature of cancer progression, we propose the existence of a clinical significant state of oligometastases. For certain tumors, the anatomy and physiology may limit or concentrate these metastases to a single or a limited number of organs. Certainly with the newer imaging modalities, when they're multicolored, they provide inviting targets for radiation. So where do we have aggressive management of oligometastases? Certainly in colorectal cancer, resection, ablation, or SBRT of liver metastases. Renal cancer, resection, ablation, SBRT of isolated systemic metastasis, sarcoma, and also looking at the NRG-RTOG protocol BR001 for oligometastasis arising in breast, lung, or prostate with SBRT. Here is some ongoing clinical trials as outlined by Dr. Kim Corbin in 2013, working with Dr. Hellman Wechselbaum when she trained at University of Chicago. We now have the good fortune of having her on staff at our institution. This paper, which was just published last year, has really has gotten a lot of coverage, if you will. Whenever I tend to see a talk on oligometastasis at international meetings, this paper is brought up, and essentially what it shows is metastasis to metastasis seeding occurs. It's not as if the metastasis come from one aggressive primary, but they can go to different sites in the body, evolve, produce different clones, and then provide secondary seeding. So it occurs either by a linear or by a branching pattern of spread. This particular study, they analyzed multiple metastatic sites in 10 different patients and did detailed genetic analyses showing this. So looking at some radioimmunotherapy, ipilimumab versus placebo after radiotherapy in patients with metastatic castrate-resistant prostate cancer. This is Eugene Kwan. This is a urologist that I work with who doesn't do surgery but is trained also as an immunologist. So he participated in this trial and actually wrote it up. And Whenever a urologist is saying something positive about radiation therapy, we want to make note. And thus, radiotherapy is a rational modality to stimulate immune priming amenable to subsequent amplification by ipilimumab. And here is basically the schema was they would be primed with 800 centigrade times 1, prednisone plus ipi versus placebo, and the overall survival of the entire group didn't quite make the 0.05 level, but for patients that had lower volume disease, they actually did quite well. This remains an open question, but we don't do this routinely just because of some of the toxicity of ipi. There can be fatal complications. And here's the favorable risk patients that actually did show a benefit with this modality. So I think we're going to see more of this with different different types of systemic therapy, but not necessarily ipi at the present time. So let's take a look at metastatic sites, frequency, and overall survival. If we look at a study published several years ago, a Swiss study in 2008, sentinel lymph node mapping study. And this is important because we need to take a look at what do we routinely include in pelvic lymph node fields for prostate cancer and other malignancies, and actually where does the disease reside. And in this paper, he broke it down to six different regions, and they injected a patient's prostates who had localized prostate cancer, but the prostate was intact and they hadn't been treated yet, with technetium-99M labeled nanoparticles, and then identified where the sentinel nodes were based on after that injection, and found that if you see in the first one, the external iliac and obturator is a little more than a third of the patients, the internal iliac a quarter of the patients, the presacral and the pararectal was less than 10%. Now those first two bars are usually included in typical lymph node, pelvic lymph node fields as outlined by different studies. The presacral and pararectal, a portion of the presacral are involved, but the others, common iliac, the periaortic caval, and the inguinal are typically not included in those treatment fields. And the reason I bring this up is that when we do some of this advanced imaging and some of the abstracts that we've recently submitted, they'll hopefully be presented this year, we do identify a number of patients where they have lymph node recurrence. It's just that the recurrence is outside your traditional pelvic lymph node fields. And then if we take a look at cause-specific modality for pathologically proven lymph node positive recurrence, we have that patients with local and or nodal recurrence versus retroperitoneal recurrence, their survival out of 5 years can be 80%, so that's quite high. Skeletal bone metastasis is worse, and the visceral metastasis is even worse than that. This is a study published in 2015. And how does this compare to older data looking at distribution of metastatic sites when patients present? And by far, it is bone metastasis. So if we can catch the disease prior to it being obviously having spread to bone, then we may be able to do some good. We may be able to offer a patient higher survival if we have a lot of faith and confidence that our imaging modality is showing the majority, if not all, of the prominent disease locations. And here's another study looking at, once again, long-term survival based on the sites of metastatic spread, with lymph nodes having the best prognosis, followed by bone, and then followed by a visceral involvement. So this is really a dilemma, whether one's in radiation oncology, urology, medical oncology, a patient presents originally with localized disease, has primary treatment, whether it's prostatectomy or radiation or both, and then you're following the patient and the PSA rises. And they're coming in to see you, their PSA is 1 to 2, and you know, what do you do? Do you wait till the PSA goes to 3, put them on empiric androgen deprivation therapy? You do imaging studies with bone scan, MRI, and CT scan. You often don't find it. Well, what do you do? It would be nice to have imaging modalities that actually identified where the disease was. Is it just locally recurrent, or is it locally recurrent with lymph node involvement? So, and one of the complaints I do hear from some of my colleagues in urology is that, well, when a patient comes in with a rising PSA post-prostatectomy and they're referred for salvage radiation therapy, you really don't know that the disease is only there or it's there at all, even if you do some of the imaging. And, I think there is some validity to that complaint. We do have such a great deal of data looking at salvage radiation therapy, and it is effective in a certain high percentage of patients, but still, in many cases, we are radiating the prostate bed without knowing for sure that that's the location of the disease or if that's the only location of the disease. So these are some slides from some of my colleagues in nuclear medicine who've been very closely involved in these efforts to utilize more advanced imaging techniques in finding the location of prostate cancer recurrence. And this is a list of a number of tracers. At the top of the list, C11 choline, that's what we've emphasized at our institution. A few years ago, the FDA changed their rules regarding when you can use a novel tracer, so to speak, at your institution. It used to be that you could just get IRB approval, but a few years ago the FDA said, no, you're going to have to get FDA approval in order to do that if you want to have full billing with it. So we actually submitted an application to the FDA to be able to image with C11 choline, and along with it was an $1.8 million check for the application, quite extensive, and requested a waiver, but you still have to submit it, and then they waived the fee, but it took a good 3 to 6 months to get that approved. So we've really heavily emphasized C11 choline. This is something that has been used in Europe even as long ago as a decade. But right now, the one at the bottom, gallium 68 PSMA, is where people in Europe and Australia are imaging quite extensively. F18 fluorocholine, the chemistry of that is a little different. F18, at the half-life of 111 minutes, you can usually ship that a lot better, and you can't C11, which has a 20-minute half-life. We have two cyclotrons, and we are doing 40 to 60 of these a week, and we're having technicians that run from the cyclotron over to three CT scanners to actually do it. C11 acetate is another one that is also being used extensively, F18 fluoroacetate, and then F18 fluoro cyclobutene carboxylic acid, and gallium 68 PSMA. F18 FDG for diagnosing metastatic prostate cancer with rising PSA, we have found is not to be a very good one unless a patient is developing some neuroendocrine differentiation. We do seem to have some good results with that. So take a look at F18 FDG, just to comment on that. Limitations in prostate cancer. Tumor positivity with FDG relies on increase in glucose transport, increase in intracellular hexokinase. It has limitations with prostate cancer just because of its metabolism. And taking a look at the ACR appropriateness criteria from 2011, it is really considered not to be something to that's warranted for routine use. Whereas even in 2014, looking at C11 choline PET, it is indicated as something that is acceptable and to be considered for patients with rising PSA post-treatment. And here's more of the same. Now, what is it about C11 choline? It has a methyl metabolism, cholinergic neurotransmission, transmembrane signaling. It has phospholipid transport and metabolism. It's upregulated with high affinity transport, moves choline into the cell, increased choline kinase phosphorylates choline, and it's incorporated in cell membranes of proliferating tumor cells. And here's a study from our institution, and it did include a mixture of patients from going almost 3 years ago. But basically, looking at these PSA ranges, for our FDA approval of C11 choline, it was basically rising PSA post-primary therapy with a PSA greater than 2, where we found out that we would be able to detect these sites of recurrence in about 70% or more of the patients. If a patient has a rapid PSA doubling time, a high Gleason score, we you can tell that we actually do image patients with lower PSAs, typically not less than 0.5, but I've had one that's been biopsy proven in a lymph node with a PSA of 0.28. So we can find where these recurrences are. The assumption is that it's a good portion of where the recurrences are, and then we act upon that. And here's another study that we did in patients that are post-radical prostatectomy, where all patients underwent C11 choline PET CT and pelvic multiparametric MRI. And we were looking for local recurrence, lymph node recurrence, or bone metastasis. And it was 115 patients. And basically, 30% had disease outside the pelvis. 20 extra pelvic nodal metastases, 19 extra pelvic bone metastases. But let me show you some examples. Here's an MRI is a false negative, PET is true positive. And patients were judged to definitely have involvement there if they responded to treatment or if they had a biopsy proof of involvement at that site. Here's another one with a bone metastasis. Both modalities are true positive. And I show this because what I try to emphasize in my practice is doing biopsies whenever feasible to verify that the patient is newly diagnosed with lymph node involvement or bone involvement, because it's a big difference between that and having a localized disease, and interventional radiologists that do this quite a bit. And getting down to the results of this, looking at local recurrence, we found that actually MRI is still superior to C11 choline PET in identifying local recurrence, whereas with pelvic lymph node metastasis, we find that the PET is better at finding that than the MRI. So the two are complementary, and the two are both very good for identifying bone metastasis, so we don't routinely get bone scans in these patients, although I've pointed out and discussed with our nuclear medicine folks that our PET scans are from the mid-orbits to the mid-thighs. So if patients, for example, have a fibula metastasis or something on the top of the cranium, we might miss it, but those are quite rare events. So conclusions for this part of the talk and some of our experience using the C11 choline PET CT in over 2,600 patients and 6,400 scans in the past 3 to 5 years is that MRI and C11 choline PET CT are complementary in restaging biochemically recurrent prostate cancer. MRI is superior for local recurrence, facilitates localized salvage treatments. Choline PET is superior for lymph node metastasis, and both equally excellent for identifying bone metastasis. Let's talk about some of these other agents. Here is one I mentioned before, the F18-FACBC PET-CT. And here's an example, patient with bone metastasis and nodal metastasis. And here is one small study comparing the two, 15 patients with biochemical relapse following definitive therapy for prostate cancer. Choline was positive in 3 of 15 patients, whereas FACBC was positive in 6 of 15 patients. The tissue-to-blood ratio was higher with FACBC and greater than 70% of lesions. So in this small series, it suggests that FACBC may be even better than C11 choline. We don't have experience at our institution with this, but this is something that's deserving acknowledgement that others are looking into this. Here is one that, once again, is really being used quite extensively through Europe and Australia, positron-labeled prostate-specific membrane antigen. And the other thing is gallium-68, if you're familiar, is something that can be utilized in a generator, doesn't require a cyclotron on site. It binds to the extracellular domain of PSMA and is internalized into the prostate cancer cell. And how this particular antibody differs from prostacin is prostacin was actually an intracellular epitope. It would still bind that particular antibody, but it was not as specific as the current PSMA. And this is something that is being produced in Heidelberg, Germany, and as I understand it, they're charging about $1,000 a dose, which is much less than they could charge. They're saying it's just they're charging what the cost is. But right now, as of a few weeks ago, this PSMA was not FDA approved in North America. And here's a comparison of F18 choline. Once again, does have some different chemistry than C11 choline versus gallium-68. And here is a slide provided by Steve Williams from the Peter MacCallum Cancer Center in Melbourne, Australia, comparing these two, and at least a back of the envelope calculation is the sensitivity is suggested to be approximately double what it is with C11 choline, but I think we need more detailed head-to-head studies with the same patient cohorts before we can actually make these good comparisons. So oligometastatic prostate cancer radiotherapy, where can we derive some indications? If we have a patient that comes in after primary radiation therapy, for example, PSA of 3, you do some imaging and find that there's, a pelvic lymph node involvement, maybe some periaortic lymph node involvement. Can you justify giving this patient treatment with, say, neoadjuvant concomitant and extended duration hormonal therapy along with radiation therapy? Is it symptomatic versus asymptomatic? Is it hormone sensitive or is it castrate resistant? And what are some of the site-specific approaches and the results? And here's a list of what I go over with residents when I'm referred patients for consideration of treatment that's outside the box, if you will. And we need to present these in chart rounds and with others who may have a different philosophy or perspective on this. And we use this as an academic exercise. We're looking for studies or guidelines that justify treatment of what disease that we find on these scans in patients who, say for example, are hormone naive, that we're going to give them hormonal therapy and give them also concomitant radiation therapy as opposed to just hormonal therapy alone. So for locally advanced prostate cancer recurrence in patients, for example, who are castrate resistant and yet have symptomatic local recurrence, there are several studies where it's supported by retrospective data. Pelvic lymphadenopathy is supported by NCCN guidelines and retrospective data, including several publications within the past several years. Periaortic lymphadenopathy, that's where we're starting to move outside the box, but they were included in a subset of RTOG 8531 patients, a small percentage, but they were included in this particular clinical trial. Bone metastasis, if they're symptomatic, that's not an issue at all. If they're asymptomatic to the spine with epidural disease, we could we certainly can include that. But if they're asymptomatic bone metastasis, we really refer to ongoing clinical trials, particularly the NRG clinical trial, and also retrospective data. Visceral metastasis, however, there's very limited retrospective data for symptom management or treatment. So here is one study looking at castrate-resistant local recurrence with delivering localized radiation therapy. You can see also a study from MD Anderson over 20 years ago where they compared patients with hormone refractory localized recurrence in the prostate with no evidence of gross metastasis, where they treated patients with different fractionation regimens and found that actually higher doses of conventionally fractionated radiation therapy provided a better long-term control than using more palliative doses, say 300 times 10. Here is also looking at the NCCN guidelines, just even from 2014, if you have a patient who undergoes radical prostatectomy and lymph nodes are involved, that you can, it says plus or minus pelvic radiation therapy, so certainly if patients have lymph node involvement limited to the pelvis, giving radiation therapy to the pelvis in addition to androgen deprivation therapy is, you're well within your rights based on the review of the literature and what are considered to be acceptable guidelines. Here is a study from our institution over 20 years ago when it was considered to be a little heretical to continue in doing a radical prostatectomy in patients that were found to have lymph node positive disease, but this is something that was pursued by our surgeons, and if they didn't necessarily undergo radical prostatectomy with lymph node positive disease, they would also be treated with radiation, and showing that local therapy plus androgen deprivation therapy, at least in this retrospective study, was better than just just androgen deprivation therapy alone. Here's a study from the University of Colorado published in 2014 looking at clinically node-positive or pathologically node-positive disease and whether to give local therapy to the lymph nodes or not, and showing at least in this study that there is an advantage. One study I don't show is from Jason's group at MGH, Dr. Lin, also published a similar type study. Here is one. It's a combined study between Milan and our institution, looking at patients who undergo radical prostatectomy, are found to have lymph node involvement, whether they receive adjuvant radiation therapy alone, that's the bottom line, or they, adjuvant hormonal therapy alone, or they receive both adjuvant hormonal therapy and radiation. And in at least with this study, taking a look at the 10-year cancer-specific survival, it's improved from 70% to 86%. But once again, this is not level one evidence. This is a retrospective level two type evidence. Here is an example of something published in the literature using C11 choline PET CT as a guide for radiation treatment in lymph node relapses in prostate cancer patients, and something that's been keeping me very busy in my practice. I'll give you an example here. Case 1, stage 4 prostate cancer, 81-year-old with PSA rebound in primary prostate cancer, treated with external beam radiation therapy. PSA goes from 0.6 to 2.6. C11 choline PET CT reveals pelvic lymph node involvement, the right common iliac node. He's referred for radiation therapy. He is treated with androgen deprivation therapy, and we also treat the uninvolved lymph nodes to 45 gray and 25 fractions, and then the involved sites to 56, 25, and 25 fractions. We biopsy when we can, and here's an example of where we see this on the PET scan. And here's the radiation dose. We match to the prior field without overlapping. And what we don't have is long-term results comparing the two. I look at this as pilot data, hopefully for multi-institutional prospective trials that are going to take years to develop. And certainly this is a provocative food for thought, photons versus protons and periodic radiation therapy. We can certainly reduce the bowel dose if we're going to use protons instead of photons in this particular setting. Improvement in dose volume histograms, not something that we're doing routinely, but something for future consideration. So moving on to looking at bone metastasis, SBRT for prostate cancer, oligometastasis, a multi-institutional study included data from our institutions led by Pete Oost from Ghent in Belgium. So 119 patients to 163 sites, 53 of them also had lymph node positive disease, M1A in 19 patients, bone M1B in 43 patients. Please excuse the unmatched parenthesis there. Viscera in 4 patients. So there was no castrate-resistant prostate cancer patients, patients that had less than 12 months of ADT prior to SBRT, and found that, at least in this retrospective study, that there was a dose response depending on what the biologically effective dose was. So to summarize, how is this moving forward? We definitely have improved imaging with C11 choline, PSMA, C11 acetate, and others to identify where prostate cancer metastases are occurring earlier in the disease process. One thing I didn't comment on, but I will note, is that we have had a very limited experience of some of my colleagues several years ago doing SBRT on isolated lymph node recurrences. But what we've found that that these patients will recur, and a lot of times if they recur within a few centimeters of where the SBRT was performed, that compromises the treatment. In this year's GU ASCO, there was an abstract from another institution where they looked at retrospectively SBRT versus doing fractionated treatment to larger lymph node chains, and found that there were higher recurrences in the lymph nodes if one was using SBRT. Furthermore, when you look at series of patients who undergo a pelvic lymphadenectomy and use and compare, say, for example, the C11 choline with how many sites appeared to be involved in the C11 choline and how many lymph nodes in different stations they find involved, they often find, say, lymph node involvement in sites with 3 millimeters or less are not always picked up on C11 choline. So our approach is to treat these in in stations as opposed to SBRT. Bone metastasis is a different story. We will combine that with SBRT for bone metastasis, but if it's immediately adjacent to the sites of lymph node involvement, then we'll treat that with a fractionated course. So what are some of the indications for radiation therapy in this setting? Once again, to review this, local symptomatic disease, a pelvic lymphadenopathy, those two are relatively straightforward. Periaortic lymphadenopathy, bone metastasis, symptomatic, spine, or a limited number. Visceral, if symptomatic, but really they have the poorest overall prognosis and the most limited data in terms of the utility. Typically, if we have a PET scan that shows, for example, mediastinal involvement, we'll try to determine whether that's inflammatory, if there's actual involvement there, and then we, for the most part, shy away from giving radiation to the mediastinum for prostate cancer oligometastasis. So thank you very much for your time. It's a pleasure to be here. Thanks.
So that was great. We had two wonderful talks. Before actually I bring up our next section on bladder, actually I'm going to take artistic license and bring Dan up. We're going to do some questions and answers. You know, technology truly changes us. How many of you have an Apple Watch on? Anybody have an Apple Watch? So as you know, if you have an Apple Watch on, but right about now, it's annoying you to stand up, right? You missed your 5 minutes, right? So anybody wants to stand up while Dan comes up to the stage, gives us a little stretch, right? We want to break up the monotony of giving four lectures in sequence. So let me start. We'll do about 10 minutes of questions, and then we'll do the bladder session. For those of you, you know, that last session, some of the advanced imaging may be very new to some of you. If you don't think it's hit the mainstream, it's hit the mainstream. And so I had the pleasure of presenting from our group 600 patients in a urology meeting of significance approximately a month ago. And at the end of it, in showing data on C11, acetate but not choline, which very similar results, the urologist who is one of a prominent urologists in the U.S., which most of us know, would said, and I quote, "Fundamentally, these kind of imaging will change the way we practice for the patients with advanced disease. If you can find where the site is, and you think it's actually true, and it's just that site, then the treatment with radiation becomes much more relevant." In addition, for those of you who know me, I've spent the last 8 years of my life building approaches that combine radiation with immune approaches. And so with a trial that we have currently, we're using radiation coupled with immunotherapy to try to elicit, if you know that you just have this area or a few areas, could you actually use radiation to elicit what some would call the abscopal effect, but we would call inducing systemic, i.e. immune responses. All right, so let me ask the first question for prostate, really to Dan. So Dan, you know, the U.S. task force basically says we shouldn't screen men over 75, right? And how many of you in the audience have seen a shift in your practices from patients with low risk or earlier disease not really come into your practices, and what we're seeing is patients with more higher risk? Can we just show hands? Almost everybody sees it and feels it. Data from various groups, including ours, recently published, showed that there is a shift from lower to higher risk. Now, with that, the battleground for prostate cancer becomes high-risk therapy because patients are coming in later. And Dan's data was fantastic, but that's the area we have the least data. So what do you think we need to do, Dan, with respect to developing data with respect to the high-risk patient?
I mean, it's a great question, and I don't know what the correct answer is. I just touched on it briefly. UCLA is running a multi-institutional trial. They're assuming, I think, about 250 patients total. They're treating the prostate for sure with androgen ablation, and they're allowing people to treat the lymph nodes if they want. So I think that'll be important data to get. Other people, especially I think in the light of the ASCEND-RT trial, have argued that SBRT might be a non-invasive way to boost the prostate gland when combined with conventionally fractionated radiation therapy to the pelvis and the prostate. So I think either of those are potential options, although the data is really relatively limited for both of them.
Agreed. And, you know, it's going to be an interesting problem for our profession. Dan and I were both at GU ASCO, and our friend Matt Cooperberg, how many urologists in the room? Okay, we can talk about them. So, said that the optimal treatment for high-risk prostate cancer is surgery. And so, again, as the battleground for helping patients with prostate cancer becomes higher-risk disease, we need to continue to build effective approaches. It's another question for Dan. You know, the Timmerman paper is, a wonderful paper, which was a phase one trial to try to find the dose that would actually hurt people. And they felt that in the phase one part, the 50 was good. And then ultimately, it was shown to have, again, five of six colectomies. Now, that trial was done using a rectal balloon, correct?
Correct.
So, you know, my old mentor, and those who know me know I did surgery for 10 years, said anatomy is destiny. And when we use the rectal balloon, do we not push the anterior part of the rectum up against some, you know, the DVH is better in general, but the anatomic piece of the anterior part is actually closer.
I think Dr. Timmerman's hypothesis, and it was a hypothesis, you can question whether it was a reasonable hypothesis or not, but his hypothesis was based on some of the contact data, particularly from France, where you put in a probe and you radiate the rectum, you ablate it, and then it heals by essentially secondary intention. And so his idea was to use not only a rectal balloon, but use a very, very large rectal balloon. And so if you look at their data, they not only quantify the rectal dose, but they quantify the anterior rectal wall dose, the lateral rectal wall, the posterior rectal wall dose. And the assumption was that this would heal from clonogens from outside the field. And by using a larger balloon, you would enable more of the rectum to be out of the field. I thought that was a bit of a fallacy before he did it. I think it was a bit of a fallacy after he did it. I think what's even more important, you can argue whether or not they should have done the phase one trial, but if you look at the publication that was published in JCO, they selected this as an acceptable dose with only 9 months follow-up on average in the high-dose arm, and I think that's just not appropriate and turned out to be not appropriate. So a rectal balloon, we don't personally use them with SBRT. I think they probably don't add a lot of value, but there certainly are a lot of people that do use them. I think you just need to be cautious because, yes, the anterior rectal wall is in contact. I'm less worried about that, but you can sometimes push the seminal vesicles around the balloon. And so if you're going to treat, for instance, seminal vesicles in an intermediate risk patient, you might increase the rectal dose because the seminal vesicles are now draped around the balloon. It may actually put the anal rectal junction more into the dose as well. And we had some quality of life data that suggested that the anal rectal doses might be most important for anal rectal function and quality of life. So I am not a strong proponent of balloons. If for no other reason than I just kind of icky to stick those in every day.
Yeah, and I don't remember seeing in that paper exactly the colostomy specimens, right? So anatomy's destiny. So where was the actual problem that required the colostomy? So right, if it's all anterior, you know, maybe it was us and it was the balloon pushing it. So, do we have questions from the audience? Please come up to the mic. Meanwhile, while people are coming to mic, I have one more. For Brian, you know, that you brought up the SBRT. We have a question there. We'll take that question in the corner, and then I'll do Brian's question.
Yeah, I mean, I would agree that the SBRT may be better concentrated with the higher risk patients rather than all the studies that you showed. Most of them are dominated by the low risk, and it amazes me how the IRBs at these institutions let low-risk men into these studies when they have a cause-specific survival of exceeding 10 years, but we're doing 5 times 10 or 24 times 1, you know, all these regimens when these men are going to do fine. And I would vote on the side of caution for, you know, a lot of these regimens, because I think that the studies are still early in terms of the number of patients who have been followed for long periods. A lot of them include significant numbers with 1, 2, 3 year follow-ups, and I think for rectal and for GU toxicity, I think you need longer. You're going to see some late effects, and for tight margins, I think there's going to be a risk of failure with this too. So I think we need to wait But again, if we're going to do it, I think high risk is more the need, you know, where there is a lot of failures with conventional. And the other question about the gallium 68, is that going to be ready for the U.S. and is going to be too cost prohibitive? It seems like a better way to go.
In regard to the first, I mean, in general, I agree with you. I've been a nihilist in general. I do think it's worth noting that, for instance, in quality of life data, the SBRT cohorts have done a better job of publishing longer-term quality of life data than most of the conventionally fractionated IMRT cohorts. And so they have published data with hundreds of patients with five-year quality of life in the large IMRT cohorts, mostly haven't published much past 2 or 3 years. We had data from Michigan for quality of life that suggested that at 2 years, 7 years, and 15 years, in fact, the bowel quality of life was relatively stable. So I think the data that's out there is good. In terms of the high risk, you know, we actually tried to run our trial more in high risk data, and our IRB said, you don't know that this is safe, you don't know this is effective. We don't want you to, you know, run a trial that's potentially not safe and potentially not effective, so we want you to run it in patients who it's more of the safety concern. But I agree, moving this into higher risk patients now that safety, I think, has largely been demonstrated is probably the appropriate thing to do.
So with respect to the gallium 68, as I stated, it's my understanding it's not it's not FDA approved in the United States. I have heard that there is a center in New York, Sloan Kettering, that is doing it on a limited basis, and IRB, and maybe some other people in the audience have some information, because this is really a rapidly moving target. But from our experience, and one thing that I really work to emphasize is that with these patients, that we go ahead and biopsy it whenever we can to try to get a true positive result. I mean, sometimes you might get a false negative result if the biopsy wasn't done right. But some abstracts that we've submitted to some of the national meetings recently, we're able to biopsy about 50% of the patients to confirm these, where many other studies it's down around 10%. The one study I showed you at the FACBC versus the C11 choline, that was only 15 patients. I think those are the types of studies that we need to run, is to examine these with multiple modalities and then get biopsy confirmation before we can actually say that one is more sensitive or specific than the others. What I have heard about gallium 68, however, is that it may be, you may get a higher false positive rate with that than C11 choline, but nonetheless, it appears to be more sensitive from comparing different institutions and results.
Question in the back.
Yes, hi. My name is Greg Franklin. Just a quick question on the extreme hyperfractionation. I'm somebody that has used moderate hyperfractionation. I'm a little bit hesitant on the extreme fractionation, mainly because of the point that the previous questioner brought up, but also some of your data looking at smaller margins that have been used to show improved, decreased in toxicity. But my concern is more that a lot of times with prostate cancer, as we all know, it may take 10 years or so to show sort of efficacy type results. And if using smaller margins, how is there a lot of data looking at what might be the appropriate margin to use for these extreme hyperfractionation patients? And are you somewhat concerned that maybe 10, 12, 15 years out that maybe seeing more failures in those patients? Thank you.
I mean, I would say bluntly, no. On the other hand, I don't think we have that data for anything we do for margins for prostate radiotherapy. I mean, many people are using 5-millimeter margins and a 4-millimeter margin posteriorly. So I don't know that to me makes a strong difference one way or the other. I also think we're fooling ourselves if we really think the margin means that, the PTV margin means that much. There's still a relatively large gradient that goes around these things, and so there is dose covered. I think it's the same argument that's been made about brachytherapy for 20 years, and the brachytherapist said, look, we cover the periprostatic tissues with a dose distribution. There's been a lot of modeling studies that have suggested that, you know, with an SBRT-like plan, you can get a dose distribution that looks very much like an HDR plan. I think in terms of toxicity, if you look back 12 years to the early days of HDR and 20 years to the early days of LDR, you know, you saw things like high rates of urinary stricture, you know, in some studies up to 20% rates of urinary stricture. You saw rates of rectal fistulas. I think that is part of the learning curve. And I think, in fact, Timmerman's study is somewhat remarkable in that he's the only one that has shown such drastic negative results. And I think his was a little bit of a fallacy to begin with.
So we'll take two questions, one there and then one in the middle.
Sure. Shane Hopkins from Iowa. Just kind of a practical question in terms of the Dr. Davis's talk on oligometastatic disease. If you have gross disease in the lymph node, it seems like you mentioned 56 gray as one possible dosing method, and how you fractionate that. It seems like there's not a lot of guidelines. So do you have any kind of, I guess, summary as to how you might approach bone disease or lymph node disease or a combination if you're treating the prostate or prostate bed and how you would go about
Well, the big thing is, first of all, is the patient castrate resistant or not? And if they're not castrate resistant, the single most effective therapy is androgen deprivation. And the whole purpose of this is to improve on what we expect the long-term results of androgen deprivation therapy are. We have retrospective data, at least in pelvic lymph nodes, that there appears to be some benefit to that. It's not level one evidence, but certainly level two, and something that's made its way in the guidelines. So if you start with that, you say, okay, giving extra radiation to the lymph nodes in patients with lymph node involvement, that is something that's within guidelines and something that appears to offer some benefit, then if you have an image guidance method, a metastasis-directed therapy, what we will do is we'll treat all the way, certainly usually always above the common iliac, just because we find involvement there. The studies that I showed you, plus in some of the work that we hope to get out there this year, is that these patients do recur in the common iliacs, and it's an easy thing to extend the treatment up to L4, L5, or L3, L4. We'll treat the whole lymph node chain, say if they had prior radiation, get the old radiation records and match. Treat the whole pelvic lymph node chain to 45 gray and 25 fractions. And for those sites, and we only do the radiation after we've given 3 to 4 months of hormonal therapy, so that the lymph node bulk of the disease has shrunk dramatically. And we'll boost individual sites depending on what the location of the adjacent normal organs are, whether it's 50 and 25, if we get to go to 56, 25, at 225 a day, we'll do that. If it's a patient who has, for example, some evidence of castrate resistance, a larger node, he's a heavy patient, has critical organs further away, we actually will do 62, 50, and 25 fractions. Some of my colleagues in GYN will do the same thing. If there's an isolated bone metastasis, say in the sacrum, that's immediately adjacent to that, we will include that in the treatment field and typically go 50 and 25. If there's an isolated spine metastasis, we work with our interventional radiologists where if and when they biopsy it, they'll also do cryotherapy and we reserve SBRT often after that. If it's not in a site where they think they can safely do cryotherapy, it's too close to the spinal cord, then we will do SBRT during the course, say a isolated spine met, during the course of also giving them pelvic radiation. Can I point to any level one evidence that says we're doing something appropriate for the patient? I can't do that. We can certainly look at evidence and say we're enhancing local control.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Yeah.
Great. And we'll take the last question in the middle.
Dan, you had shown a reference with every other day stereotactic radiation showing less long-term complications. Is that something you think is realistic enough that it should be followed up on? Is anyone following up on that? It also surely may have implications for tumor control as well.
Yeah, I don't know the answer to that. I think many of the CyberKnife institutions have tended to treat 5 days a week. Mm-hmm. The data from Toronto, for instance, they treated weekly. The randomized trial in Sweden is doing twice weekly. We started our trial about the time that data was coming out, so when we did it, we did do it twice a week. So I don't know the answer to that. I think the people that feel strongly about it feel strongly one way or feel strongly the other way. This is a relatively isolated set of data, but it is pretty remarkable the differences they saw. I'm just not sure how much the differences were their growing sense of technology and improvement. There also was a randomized trial, actually, at ASCO GU this year from the Canadian group that actually compared that answer as well. They saw modest changes in toxicity, but they didn't see a lot of differences in long-term toxicity, comparing once a weekly versus, I think they actually compared once a week versus twice a week. I personally would continue to do it 2 to 3 fractions a week. We tried to get it done between 11 and 17 days, but there certainly are lots of people that do it once a week.
So it sounds like there will be some limited ability to compare these different trials.
Yeah.
Thanks.